So, hello again. This time I will try to speak less and slower. And it's about a delicate topic that I think is very important. And I just want to put some first thoughts on the table. And it's something that we need to discuss over time as community. The main issue, the main challenge is how we can protect the narrative and the values of the community network community and to defend it from possible co-optations, appropriations by things that look like, but they are not exactly like this. All this thought and ideas came out of the netCommons project that you have heard in previous battlemesh about. It was a very... Yes. Ah, yes, but I don't know. What is this? This does not come out of my computer. So, yes, this is the title. So, this was the main graphic of the netCommons project, the idea of many community networks working together, but also focusing on all these different dimensions that one should address and think of from the engineering, that it's easy, in conceptually, I mean, because we are all here engineers, but also giving focus on politics, on law, on economics, on urban aspects I talked a lot about before. Through all this research and activism that we did in the netCommons project, the key finding for me, I put a question mark because I don't represent the project. It's just my own ideas. The key finding for me is that actually the major obstacles for community networks, it's not engineering or economics, but are actually political, legal, and social aspects. It's making all this illegal, non-obvious to people, having political pressures against the community network movements. And as an argument for what I'm saying is that we already know how to solve the economic problem. And we have very good examples of networks like Wi-Fi or Freifunk that have managed to scale and grow, as somebody said in the European Parliament, even if there are so many obstacles. So the economics, I would be provocative and say that it's not a problem. If you give the right tools to people to share their internet access, or to share the cost of an internet gateway like Wi-Fi, the numbers are all fine. I mean, you can really create networks that are better, cheaper, and everything right, but we have a lot of problems to solve at the political and social. And what we need, especially exactly because of this reason, what we need to advance, I would say, is more advocacy, more friendly regulations, or not friendly, just not, you know, warlike regulation policies, reaching out, building communities, learning, etc. And we don't need yet another blockchain saving the world solution. This is my provocative statement. Together we will have the other side, and perhaps we can have a debate around this. Just as a photo to talk about blockchain, these are just a few of the home pages of blockchain solutions that will connect everyone by everyone. You will feel reading the different texts that it's a little bit what also community networks talk about, you know, internet for everyone by anyone, one network accessed by anyone, owned by everyone, all the combination of anyone, everyone, and all together. And actually what is behind all these projects are magic routers that you put them on the plug and magically help you share your internet access, become rich, and all works without you having to touch anything. You know, you become part of this global community of good people that want to connect everyone.
And get paid,
yeah. So, many of these, I will make also a little bit more provocative statement at the end, but the key question is, commoning becomes some sort of brand. like sharing. Now we have this sharing economy that all the good people share their things. And this idea of network commons, for me, it's also itself a common good. I think I could argue that it's created by all of you that have been building over the years these networks, engaging people, managing as commons. And it's not just the infrastructure and the routers, but it's also the values and the narrative that all this work has created. And I would ask this question, should we protect this identity? Should we treat it also as a commons and help all together to protect it from this type of narratives that in my mind go against it and somehow confuse the message of what means a community networks and where we put the limits, what it's not a community network, and how can we achieve that this ideal, this concept is not appropriated by big corporations, by such projects. So talking about community, for me, these are two important keywords, the locality and the empowerment. And then we should ask how far somebody should make things easy and plug and play. How far in terms of removing the awareness of what is behind and the empowerment of the people, how little should we become engaged and responsible to make this happen, but also how far literally in terms of Silicon Valley, for example, should we give away the power, the control, and even the profit generated by these activities? Could be a community network orchestrated by a group of programmers in New Zealand that provide a new router and they control this whole commoning activity? Or should we put a geographic limit on where all this value is generated and enjoyed? And there are different things that could be far or close. Some are more difficult to localize than others. For example, hardware. We also get our routers and they are built in China. You know, they are far, no? They are built far. Some people benefit from this, but a router at the end is just a stupid box that then you can use for your purposes, but it could become more clever, no? It can collect data, it can organize economic transactions, it can do more. So then you have software on top that runs, that manages all this. You have the data stored, the accounting. There is the famous trust that blockchain helps us not to need, no? I mean, it's the argument that, you know, you don't need trust anymore. And I would say, and I would argue very strongly that actually trust is exactly what we need to build and not get for free as a present from an outsider. All these are processes. And if you remove the need for creating trust, for example, you break completely the community itself as a concept. Communities is about building trust. And then it can become even more complicated because it's not only collecting data and using it, but actually manipulating behavior. I mean, if we go to Facebook and Google, they are not just collectors of our information, but they are actually create this information, they manipulate it. So all these things can be close, far, etc. It's very complicated, and I put just now this word at the end about colonialism. I mean, we should rethink this idea of colonialism, how it manifests today, in which forms. So this is a little bit the questions. And I want to bring the example of Airbnb because it's already an established story of appropriation. Airbnb is a champion of sharing, no? It's an example of the sharing economy. But actually, there is zero sharing in Airbnb. It's just renting. I mean, it's really a crime to call Airbnb sharing. It's a mistake. It is not sharing, but through marketing and all these things, Airbnb has managed to portray itself as a sharing platform that helps us become better people, etc. But it just creates a market that benefits from it. And actually, in addition to extracting all the local value, it has very serious bad consequences in the cities themselves. I don't know who of you are from Barcelona. Barcelona or Amsterdam and are aware of all these struggles against Airbnb that has managed through this monetization of these activities to change completely the cities and have people getting out of their homes, living in cellars, just to rent them on Airbnb, and have whole neighborhoods that hear all day this luggage is coming back and forth. I think Airbnb should fund a quiet luggage patent. Anyway, so, and you could think of couch surfing, for example. Couch surfing was about sharing. And then Airbnb came to call this dynamic and transform it into something that is completely different. And I think Airbnb is not run on blockchain, but maybe it's already around some sort of block BNB or chain BNB. It could be very easily work on blockchain. And if you think a little bit about economics, Airbnb takes a percentage of every transaction. Blockchain does not do this because it's decentralized, but actually there is a speculation effect that those that create these networks extract huge values through the speculation aspect. So it's a little, it's not so obvious, but it's exactly the same thing. It's extracting value from a local commoning process to places that are very far from where this commoning takes place. So I will say very fast that there are alternatives of more commoning stuff. This is a whole presentation that I will not give, but there is an alternative currency in Sardinia that actually it's a, like blockchain, wanted to create a monetary system that it's without banks, etc. These people in Sardinia did a local currency, actually, a truly local currency that tries to create such alternatives with values that are much more closer. And I have written a paper creating a parallel between Sardex and GWIFI, community networks and community currencies facing similar problems of appropriation, etc. So I will go very fast and say, for me, a takeaway is that we need experts, we need tools that help people do things better or worse. We cannot do everything alone. And people that don't have technical knowledge expect from them to set up routers and make configurations. But I think we should not demonize expertise, but localize it. I mean, all this type of solutions and tools, for me, a definition of a community network would be that all this stays as much as possible locally. Of course, if there is not a factory to make chips and silicon, etc., this is impossible. But for whatever it's possible to have local institution structures, it should be it. And I will end with an interesting story that I sent a message to the list, which created a big noise around it. I got threatened online. But anyway, this is not the issue. The issue is that this specific solution, Amber, was a blockchain solution that was supported by community networks. And for me, I think this is not the case anymore. But I put it as an image for you to think how it could happen and how it could be dangerous, that things that in my mind don't correspond at all to the community network values can create collaborations and alliances that could give them a little bit of this positive air that you all as a community have created, and take advantage of it or not take advantage. I don't know what is the, what happens now with Amber. So, yes, this is my position statement. Thanks. Yes, if you have some clarifications, questions, I don't know, as you want. We can make the debate. Yeah.
I just might say a couple of words about Linux.
So in Linux, we received a request from a guy from Amber that we both know. Me and Panos, we have been working on the netCommons project together in the last few years. And basically what they told us was, we're going to do this, and there is this more or less this description that you can find in the white paper. And the day that we have something that more or less works, we may want to involve communities to try it out. And if you go on the page, I think the logo is still there. If you click on the logo, it opens a blog post in the Linux community, in the Linux blog. And basically what the blog post says is, as long as this is open source, as long as this is hardware that we can refresh, and more or less these are the constraints, then yes, if you do something, you can ship it to us, and we're going to try to see if we make some use of it. And that's why the logo is there.